Superior Court of Forsyth County is now in session. The Honorable Senior Judge Robert W. Adamson presiding.
Good morning. Be seated, please. First, let me tell you who I am, because although I've been in Forsyth County before on senior judge assignments, it's been a while. I'm Bob Adamson. I became a member of the bar after graduating from UGA Law School in 1971. I practiced law for 21 years. We had offices in Winder and Lawrenceville, and I covered generally Northeast Georgia. I went to the bench, or started doing Superior Court bench work as an assigned magistrate in 1992 after being elected to a Superior Court judgeship. I served until the end of 2008, at which time I retired and accepted senior status. I'm also a mediator, an arbitrator, and I do some special master work in addition to mediation and settlement conference work and senior judge assignments. I live in Bexar County between Winder and Watkinsville, which, if you know how to go the Beaufort Dam Road, is not too hard to get to. If you go the other highway, it takes a couple of hours to get here. So I took the Beaufort Dam Road and came right here with no problem at all this morning. Let me first ask the parties to introduce the folks at the table so I will know who I'm speaking to in regard to each of the issues that we're here to cover, the plaintiff in the case.
Sure, Your Honor, thanks for being here today and coming down from Winder. We appreciate it. I'm Kelly Campanella. I'm an Assistant Attorney General representing the Office of the Attorney General, Sam Olens, today. At council table with me is Senior Assistant Attorney General Stefan Ritter.
What's the name again?
Stefan Ritter.
Good morning, Your Honor. My name is Kevin Tallant. I am with Miles Patterson Hansford Tallant. We have the privilege to represent the city of Cumming. Along with me is my partner, Mr. Dana Miles, and Mayor H. Ford Gravitt of the city of Cumming. And the court may see me from time to time turning around, talking to the lady behind me. This is Ms. Lauren Giles, an associate with our firm. She is here with us also today.
All right, you don't have enough room to put her at the table.
Well, we'll make this work, Your Honor. We don't want to get things too crowded over here.
All right. Well, that's fine. However you want to deal with the problem. Thank you. Let's make sure first that we all are in agreement as to why we're here. The notice that I sent out in response to the suggestions of the parties was that we address the motion for summary judgment and the motion to dismiss, both of which are pleading motions and both of which are currently pending before the court. Both of these motions, as I understand it, are non-evidentiary motions. In other words, they'll be resolved on evidence which has been submitted without objection or otherwise admitted through the pleading process. So what we're not here for is a bench trial or an evidentiary hearing or any other form of evidence gathering or evidence weighing. I have reviewed, I had most of the relevant pleadings in hand because you sent it to me earlier this morning. I was a little bit late coming in here because I spent my time reviewing again the case file, and I think I have a pretty good grip on what is contained within the record. I recognize that first we're dealing with rather simple facts, but in some instances, very new. That's the first case I can recall where I've dealt with a statute that went into effect the same day the event occurred that's in question, which a portion of the statute in this case did. We may be dealing with some legal issues that we have to resolve in order to issue a correct ruling on the two motions that are pending in the case.
In summary, the City of Cumming's defenses and those of the mayor in his official capacity are based on sovereign immunity and a lack of waiver. Statutory construction argument that by its terms no civil fine is authorized against the City of Cumming, and then for Mayor Gravitt individually, his official immunity bars the action against him because there's no injury or damage alleged in this case and because there's no actual malice or actual intent. Either one of those alone under official immunity is enough to bar this action.
With that, have you ever come across any action in Georgia or any other state where there was a claim for injury or damage related to an open sunshine or open meeting before?
I'm not aware of one, although I can tell you one has been brought. The plaintiff in a Northern District of Georgia suit, Ms. Tisdale, the one who was there on the night in question, and the one upon who the Attorney General has brought this case, has sued the City of Cumming in federal court. We're in front of Judge Story right now, where she's claiming injury or damage. It's a 1983 action, but they've also included allegations that we violated the Open Meetings Act. But it's a 1983 action. But it's not an identical situation because, of course, we take the position, and I'll get into this later, that Ms. Tisdale was not removed from the meeting. But it's the closest thing I can think of right now, aside from the civil action in front of Judge Story, the Northern District of Georgia Gainesville Division, where we now have an action where Ms. Tisdale has brought a 1983 claim against the City of Cumming. Unless the court has any further questions for me, I'll sit down and drink some water.
I think I've exhausted you and me both. Let's take a 15-minute recess. I have, let's call it 11 o'clock. We'll start back at a quarter after.
Thank you, Mark.
Been meant, though, to single out that one hard-headed person who keeps right on closing the door in spite of the fact that the law clearly says he or she should not do so. And could it be restricted to that person as opposed to punishing the taxpayers of the entire municipality? Could it intend very clearly to address the conduct of the person who either is so carefree and negligent that he or she doesn't learn the law and apply the law, or is so bullheaded that they continue to violate the law? Are there other cases, enforcement cases, handled by your office that are currently in litigation or in the process of appeal?
No, Your Honor, you're not. And to be quite honest, there are very few that ever have to be brought because most litigants will try to resolve this with us short of a lawsuit, and that was not possible here.
All right, what I'm going to do is take a lunch break and then address the summary judgment issues. But before we do that, let me do a little housekeeping of my own. Have there been any issues to resolve this case by compromise?
Absolutely. For 2 months following the incident, there was an extended dialogue.
Well, why don't you stand up and come up here too, Ms. Town? Let's talk in terms of what is your assertions insofar as evidence to compromise this case?
Well, I don't think the defendants can dispute it, but there were the office handled as they do any allegation of a complaint, a letter asking for an explanation. And, it was attempted to be resolved.
Your Honor, if Mr. Miles and I can address the court, I'm Stefan.
Sure, I'll let you all go wild on this.
Okay. Before Mr. Tallant and Ms. Campanella were involved in this case, I think that Mr. Miles and I are both the superiors of our relative people who are speaking today, and we spent some time trying to resolve this case. And we had a very cordial relationship in trying to do that. I won't go into all the details. I will tell you, unless there's any problem with that, that I think that the sticking point was that the Attorney General wanted an admission of violation of the law in this case, and the other side was not willing to agree to that. And I think the reason is because they were concerned about that being an admission against interest in future cases. And certainly they vigorously contest liability. So that's where we are on settlement. Often I don't discuss settlement with the court, but I want you to know that that's the situation. And I think that if we could agree that it was not useful in any other, usable in any other proceeding as an admission of liability, we probably would have been able to come to a resolution.
I would concur with what Mr. Ritter said. The sticking point was the Attorney General, not Mr. Ritter, but his boss, insisted upon an admission of liability by the city. My fear was that that would be used against the city in a lawsuit by Ms. Tisdale. She hadn't filed the suit at that point in time. The Attorney General's office opinion was that she didn't have the right at that time to file that suit. She filed it anyway. We currently have pending against us exactly what I predicted would happen. That's why we were not successful in resolution. Other matters I think we could work through and did work through fairly successfully, but the sticking point was it requested an admission of liability, and the city was unwilling to do that, and therefore, because of the potential for collateral
third
party suits.
Is there a distinction between an admission of fact versus an admission of liability?
There could be, Your Honor, but in this particular case, discussion, as I understood it, was they wanted an admission that the city and Mayor Gravitt had violated the Open Meetings Act. And so if you admit to those facts, that in essence is an admission of liability.
Well, that's exactly where we're headed with the motion for summary judgment that's filed by the Attorney General. If, as I understand it, upon any of the three allegations, there is an undisputed allegation of factual sequence which constitutes a violation, then this court is going to have to rule that there was in fact at least a violation. So what are you doing if you're admitting, if you're going into this afternoon's session without a defense on any of one of the three different avenues of violation, why not go ahead and settle the case and let the federal court deal with all these issues of sovereign immunity instead of
Your Honor?
Instead of me having to do it with. I mean, we're not talking about mountains of gold here. We're talking about.
That's right.
We're talking about doing what the council tells me the city's already doing, and that is having a carefully defined, well thought out regulation by which any citizen can be safe in a meeting with recording devices or video cameras or anything else. And we already do that, I'm told.
I'm told that's the case too, and that being the case, we're delighted to see that that came out of these negotiations and ultimately lawsuit. And we, you know, frankly, from our perspective, our feet were sort of put to the fire. They called us and said, why don't you file a lawsuit because we're not going to admit to liability. I'll tell you, Your Honor, I don't want to get into the summary judgment issues, but they acknowledged this morning that no one disputes that she was ordered to stop reporting. You see the text right there. And, you know,
Leave y'all with something to talk about at lunch. I've read almost everything, I think, that's been provided in this case. Now, I have not seen the movie, but I don't think the movie adds anything to the lack of evidence on the city side. It looks very clearly to me at this point like there is no dispute over the fact that the citizen's right to record and to take video within the meeting was violated. And there has been no reason given, which is your responsibility on summary judgment response. There's been no reason given which constitutes a defense to that violation. I mean, the others are very clearly, at least at this stage of my knowledge, disputed facts. You know, I don't know whether she left the room or didn't. I don't know whether she was thrown out or wasn't. I don't know whether she was, it's disputed even that she was told by the mayor or by anyone with real authority to stop the second recording session. But if we admit that she was stopped her effort to record, and there was no excuse of disruption or interference for sight line or noise or anything else, and it hasn't been asserted, aren't we already in a state where we've admitted liability on one point of the complaint? Think about it. We'll talk about it this afternoon. Y'all talk. Eat lunch together.
Yes, sir.
Be in recess until 10 minutes after 1.
Thank you, Your Honor. I don't know what my boss.
Kelly. Yeah. Never mind.
Good job.
Fine. 23rd is probably preferable for me, but sure. Whatever suits the court and its direction.
Was it the 23rd or the 27th?
Well, the 23rd is a Friday. I was trying to get to the end of a week. The 9th is 2 weeks from tomorrow, and that was given us to
you. Just say the 30th of August for supplement.
Okay.
And there's one reason I would beg the time of. I'm supposed to leave Sunday to go on a wonderful beach trip to Panama City with my grandchildren, their in-laws, and a whole load of other people.
Oh, that's great.
So I'll be out of circuit for at least a week. Let me ask you this. Do you think you can make the same progress just between the two of you as you would with a mediator, or do you want me to order mediation, or do you want me just to leave it between the two of you?
I'm not asking for mediation. I don't oppose it, and I'm happy to follow the court's direction. I will say that Mr. Miles and I have worked very well together, I think, so I don't think that issue about communication is a problem.
Okay.
It's always an interest to having the clients coaxed a little bit, but that's where it goes.
I'm a firm believer that mediation or some form of mediation, we have what we call a judicial settlement conference program, which I guess you do have here as well.
Yes, sir.
And to me, those programs have emerged as much more important today than they were 10 years ago.
Certainly.
Because litigation is so expensive and so, our system requires so much time and so much effort that settlement is an important alternative. And I can see how it's important in this case, very important in this case.
I think from the city's perspective, we would request that perhaps Mr. Ritter and I have an opportunity to talk, and if we feel that mediation, either side feels that mediation would be appropriate, then, and for instance, if he requests it, I'll agree to it, and if he, and vice versa, I think if we can, we'll know within a week or so whether mediation would be helpful in the case, and if we need further direction, we'll contact the court in that regard. We did feel like it was important for Mr. Tallant and Ms. Campanella to briefly argue the MSJ while you're here, and you, for you to hear those arguments.
Absolutely.
But we wanted to make this announcement to the court because you'd asked us about it right before lunch, and we wanted to report back to you as soon as we got back from lunch.
Good, very good. That sounds like progress to me, and I will agree to what you propose. I will not rule on any issue or partial issue until after August the 9th. I will expect you to notify me either on or before August the 9th as to the progress that you've made in settlement. I will leave open the supplemental briefs by either party until the 30th of August, after which time I will rule both on the motion to dismiss and the summary judgment all at the same time.
Fair enough.
Thank you, Audrey.
You're the movement, Ms. Cannon.
Very well.
Go ahead, Bob.
Provides that the public shall be afforded access to meetings declared open to the public pursuant to subsection B of this code section. Visual and sound recording during the open meetings shall be permitted.
Because of the agreement, I'm not going to venture any further into an analysis of the facts at this point. However, I will reiterate what I said earlier, and that is this. Where each party submits the limited evidentiary offering that you're allowed to do on a motion for summary judgment, the court is required to consider each of you correct. So I've got to look at you and say, your analysis of Ms. Tisdale's statements on the recording are absolutely correct. But on the other hand, I have to look at the other side and say your affidavits that you've submitted as to those issues that were addressed are absolutely correct. The end result, though, is that if there's a dispute, then whoever the fact finder may be, and that may even be a mystery itself, has to evaluate the weight and credibility of Ms. Tisdale's presentation and her testimony, the chief's testimony, the mayor's testimony, any other observer's testimony that is identified as a witness. And that trier of fact also has to establish the value of any of the recordings or videos that are submitted as evidence. You have here one recording which was made by a person who is not a party to the case but is the target of the complaint. You have another recording that was in fact made by the authority of the defendant to the complaint. Neither one of those recordings are absolute on their face until a trier of fact has analyzed weight and credibility. Those are the things that I have to struggle with in regard to how far I go in resolving disputes over evidence. I will say that again, and I'm sure the city has heard it more than they want to, that there appears to be no doubt that the mayor issued a limitation on what is clearly authorized under law, and that is recording in a meeting. Now, there's also no question in this court's mind that a presiding officer, whether it be a mayor or county commission, always has the authority to maintain the decorum of a meeting, even though that person also has a responsibility of complying with the Sunshine Law. But nothing has been submitted that I'm aware of by the city to say that the camera was loud or that the camera was placed in an inappropriate position or that the persons accompanying the camera were disruptive or that there is a place provided for cameras that was not utilized. None of these defenses have been raised. Even that there is a standing rule that authorizes recording. All of those are not violations of the Open Meetings Act, but none of those defenses have been raised. So I can't anticipate a defense. I can only look at the evidence and make a decision as to whether there's been a violation. I have appreciated both of your positions in regard to this. There are some interesting questions. I'll be honest with you. Even though it will be a challenge to resolve it, I hope y'all are successful in your effort to resolve the case. Let me make one point to you that I always make as the final point of my spiel on mediation. There's one often overlooked rich reward for successful settlement or mediation, and that is a single word called finality. finality is what you get when you know it's all over. There are no more expenses, there are no more attorney's fees, there are no more sleepless nights, there are no more issues to worry with, and finality can only be accomplished by you in agreement between now and August 9th. So I wish you the best in finality. Thank you.